this is going to get into really trippy, weird territory, but I think about our UFO experiences. And if you read a lot of them from the Edgar Mitchell Foundation, they have like 5,000 abduction cases. They occur in sort of like a dreamlike state. Mm. And I think it's possibly like there's definitely connection there with like remote viewing, which also is obviously very contested. Mm. But maybe the brain is somewhat like a quantum system, mm. which there is, you know, temporal non-locality, and maybe quantum systems can send information back in time. Mm. And maybe you are actually accessing a future memory state, and it's sort of pre-memory. And sort of people maybe with strengthened caudate and putamens or whatever in their basal ganglia who are, you know, have an affinity for remote viewing can do this. And you are witnessing a thing that has a proto-architecture to it that is fundamentally impossible to sort of understand. And you are applying kind of the closest low-level meme based on media and sort of the collective onto the thing. And the thing is affecting you in a way that causes the thing to actually manifest.
Some closed loop.
It's exactly a time loop. And like the Carl Jung, an example of a time loop is Carl Jung had this patient who was super inaccessible, hyper-rationalist. As you know, Carl Jung was not rationalist at all. Mm-hmm. She has a dream of a scarab beetle that is this golden scarab beetle that is gifted to her. This is necklace. And it sort of is this beautiful, her heart opens up and it's sort of this epiphany and she doesn't know why it represents this in the dream, but she goes to, you know, therapy with Jung and she says, you know, I don't know what this dream means. You know, this is all sort of gobbledygook. This doesn't make any sense. And as she's saying this, he sees a scarab beetle on the window. Mm. So like a live scarab beetle come down on the windowsill. And he sees the scarab beetle and he like takes the scarab beetle and he gives it to her as a gift. That to me is a causal loop because she had a pre-memory of something that would happen to her. But that pre-memory required the thing to self-manifest because it changed her attentional pattern and his attentional pattern in a way that caused the thing to actually happen. Mm-hmm. And so I think there might be something around that with the alien thing where it could be this future, really transformative, exciting thing. You could be ascending to another sort of level at some point.
Does that mean through your intention, you can make the UFOs not appear? So for instance, if you're like, I don't think these are good, like the dark forest idea, and you're like, you know what? Let me place my attention elsewhere. Does that mean that it won't manifest? Or if there's a sufficient amount of people who believe in it, then it will occur for everyone?
I think so. Yeah, that would be my heretical and somewhat scientifically baseless belief is that collectively we have much more kind of thought power in terms of manifesting things than people sort of realize.
Yeah.
And I'm not a sort of Cartesian dualist. I do think that at some point in the future, I think of the whole field of parapsychology, right? And it's full of, you know, snake oil salesmen and, you know, not super rigorous thought or whatever. But think about how much money has been spent on it. $30 million, $40 million. How much do we spend on a particle accelerator?
Yeah, exactly.
You know, so it's like,
that's something else that I think about is you get people who contemn other scientists and be snide and so on when they'll say, yeah, there's no evidence for so-and-so. And I'll ask them, have you seen the work of Rupert Sheldrake? They'll be like, no. I've heard of it. Have you seen the Bigelow Institute's work? No. Have you seen Dean Radin's? Mm-hmm. Have you seen Julie Beschel's or Daryl Bem's?
Mm-hmm.
And then they're like, no. And I'm like, oh my gosh, this is the same feeling I have when I ask someone about a toe. And I'm like, why do you think your toe is supreme? Have you looked into Chris Langes?
Yeah.
Have you looked into Eric Weinstein's or have you looked into Lisi's or White's? I was speaking to Brian Greene. He's a string theorist, presumably working on physics. Mm-hmm. This is something that, I would love to talk about. Mm-hmm. And I asked him like, okay, looked into Wolfram's theory. He's like, no, I don't, like, it's been out for a couple of years. Yeah. There are papers.
Yeah.
It's like, no, you know, I have, I'm like, I don't buy that you don't have the time, man.
Yeah.
I buy that you don't have the interest. That's what I think it is. You're not interested in it because you think you have the answer, but don't pretend you're searching for physics when we're starving for alternatives and you won't look. In the same way that people are like, no, I'm this hyper-rationalist and I've researched evidence and it's clear there is no such thing as parapsychology. Have you researched any of the people that I've mentioned?
Yeah.
Maybe a curse. If it was me, yeah, I would spend 2 weeks just going into their papers. Yeah. And if I had questions, like, oh, I think there's some fundamental flaws in how they did this analysis.
Yeah.
I would contact the author.
Totally.
So I would say, like, they may say, yeah, I read their studies. I'm like, but there are flaws. Did you contact Rupert Sheldrake and ask him about it? No. I'm like, are you truly interested in the subject? Or are you just saying that trying to put on some face so that you can be a member of this erudite cohort of urbane sophisticates?
Yeah, it's exactly, it's your carrying card in a certain social milieu.
Yeah, like they don't want to lose that card of their membership of enlightened intelligentsia.
Exactly.
That's what they care about.
Exactly. I have a good friend who helped run the Princeton Parapsychology Lab called PAIR. And he has an experiment that I always present to skeptics where, and I'll say it right now, and if you can, and I think there's a lot of evidence here, and if you can find something that debunks this,
sure,
then I would love to hear it. Like, I always say that, like please, like, debunk this. Like, that would be fantastic. And it's this idea of a random event generator.
Right.
So you have a basically a binary computer. So it's super simple computer, just creates ones and zeros. You have a graphical interface that shows, you know, 1, 0, mm-hmm, 1, 0. So it's like basically like a, you know, transistor level, like what's happening. And you are tethering that to, call it like radioactive isotope decay or like a photon, mm-hmm, bouncing around a little bot, like something that's sort of provably thought of as random in quantum mechanics. And over a long enough time scale, that should be like flipping a coin, right? Like, you should get, over a long enough time scale and, you know, large enough sample size, you should get, with some expected standard deviation, you should get basically the same amount of ones as you do zeros. And he finds that in a statistically significant way, people's sort of, you know, Z-score distribution belies probability based on their intention going in terms of, the, you know, if you say, you go into the thing and you say, I want more ones to show up on the graphical interface than zeros, that over a long time scale, in a statistically significant way beyond the standard deviation, will occur. And so I think that's fascinating. Like, to me, if that is real, and Dean Radin has actually a lot of evidence around this and a data set around it, that's hard to argue with.
Yeah.
And then at that point, yeah, like, maybe that's like a weak interaction, right? That's not like manifesting a UFO on this table, but that should break your model of reality, or you at least should make you ask questions, mm-hmm, about the sort of dualist materialist worldview.
Subscribe to Theories of Everything to get notified of upcoming podcasts, as there are new full-length podcasts every week on the topics of mathematics, physics, consciousness, free will, and AI.